Conquer the Noise is a podcast produced by Unconquered, an independent agency challenging brand perspective through redefined content. This podcast is dedicated to telling stories of outstanding ideas and people who have found their way amongst the chatter. Well, Ben, Stephen, thank you so much for joining us today. I really appreciate you making the time. I know you guys are quite busy with all the success you've had in the last few years, so welcome.
Thanks for having us. It was wonderful.
Yeah, thanks for having us, Sean.
Yeah. So you guys are partners. How long have you guys been known each other? How did this whole endeavor start?
Ben, you want to take it? Go ahead.
I'll take the first part, and then I'll let you do the history. Oh, gooder. I mean, Stephen and I have known each other since high school. So I don't remember which year of high school it was, but you know, kind of back in the day, we both grew up in Arvada, Colorado, and just you know, managed to kind of stay connected and stay friends that entire time through you know, post high school, college, and then whatever kind of crazy adventures went on there. And I mean, Stephen moved to LA 2007, maybe. Stephen, is that right? Yeah, 2007, 2008. And I made the poor decision of going to law school about that same time. But, you know, kept in contact and, you know, throughout that time, just kind of randomly started running together. Not together, but running at the same time, getting into distance running. And yeah, just kept, you know, had conversations about that, went to random races together, would travel in that kind of situation. So always kind of had conversations around running and our running adventures. But yeah, I don't know if Stephen, you want to talk about kind of the how that led to good.
I mean, Ben glossed over just like 1,000 just hooligan adventures in high school and college and, you know, around the world, which is right, because we want to keep it classy. And then, yeah, from a gooder standpoint, it was weird how we both got in running. I got in a little earlier than Ben, but both kind of fell in love with it. And in 2014, we were training apart but separate to run the Grand Traverse, which is Crested Butte to Aspen. It's like 40 miles-ish. And that was 2014. And in there, ran a lot, talked a lot about running. We'd see each other, you know, a handful of times a year. And you know, I think Ben brought it up. He was like, you know, I think we should start like a company that revolved around running and like fun and fashion, because we just didn't feel like anything like that existed out there. And so talked about it. I had started several companies. And in 2015, I became obsessed with cheap sunglasses because was just didn't like spending a lot of money on eyewear. And I knew a little bit about the industry because I worked in some sports companies. And called Ben. I was like, we should do running sunglasses. And we got together and wrote a plan for, and we were off and running. And that's the super short version of it. But it really came from this idea that we ran because we thought it was fun and nothing out there was speaking to us. And so we wanted to do something that spoke to fun, and now we have goodr.
Mm-hmm. So I think like it's interesting. So I have a co-founder as well. So I have a business partner. We were friends before, we don't go quite as far back as you two. But people ask me who are thinking about bringing in a partner or an investor, you know, advice. And my advice for people is always like tread softly, tread lightly, do your due diligence, and make sure that you're compatible and you communicate well. Because one, I think like partnerships can be really difficult to manage. And I've seen people lose friendships. I've seen businesses dissolve because they couldn't come to terms or agree on things. You guys obviously have a good chemistry and something's working. You know, what do you credit to having a successful partnership over at goodr?
I'll go first. And I believe, you know, everybody always thinks goodr is an overnight success, and it is, except for it's the sixth company that I've either started or been a part of starting and have yet to like sell a company. So 5 black marks on the record. But I believe a partner is a really, really good thing because you play off each other. It kind of forces you not to get complacent. Right. Mm-hmm. I think one of the biggest things when you're starting anything is just perfection and your lag time. And so it's when you have somebody else relying on you, that's a huge benefit. Compatibility is really important. Ben and I lucked out. We are friends for a long time. But I mean, we didn't, other than like working at my dad's golf course together, we didn't work together in a professional setting. Right. And so that was definitely something that was new. And I think that we're very fortunate in complementary skill sets. Also, we have really, really deep roots and friendship that that we have to build on. And from the beginning, I've always been a really big communication person of like just talking and talking things through. And, you know, it hasn't been perfect by any means, but so to answer your question, why do I think it is? Deep roots and understanding. So we've had that a really high importance placed on communication at goodr from Ben and I to everyone. Mm-hmm. And then, I don't know, success covers up all sins.
Yeah. I mean, I would absolutely double down on the communication portion of that. It's something that certainly I was never good at to begin with, but you know, with Stephen's patience, I've gotten a little bit better at. I'm a four instead of a two now, on my communication, and my communication skills. So that's good. But I mean, it's absolutely essential. I think that's obviously any relationship, whether it's, you know, a business partnership or, you know, a marriage or whatever it might be, if you're not communicating effectively, it's, you know, chances are it's not going to succeed. Yeah. And I also think that, you know, we were 32, 33 when we kind of started this thing off. And so had, you know, a plenty of life experiences and kind of matured a bit. I would bet a lot of money that if we had started this thing when we were 22, it would have blown up a lot quicker, a lot sooner, and wouldn't have gone as far. Because, you know, you're just not as mature, or at least we weren't. I'm flabbergasted and blown away by all the really successful entrepreneurs who are, you know, 20 or 21, who managed to navigate their ways through the kind of emotional minefields of starting a company. It's insanely impressive. I could never have done it. Mm-hmm. So, you know, being a little bit older and more mature is, you know, it's just something I needed and had to get to. And then, you know, I'll pump some legal tires here a little bit just so I can justify all the student loans I have. But there's a bit of like good fences make good neighbors situation too. Like, you know, we had all our legal docs lined up from the get-go. And so we knew exactly how much everyone owned of what. And so there was never any of those little squabbles that could have led to bigger problems. It's kind of you just knew how it was going to go. And that was before there was any money. I mean, you know, yeah. It was negative money for quite some time. I think communication has to be number one on that list.
Yeah, we did a similar thing where the first things that we put in place were actually legal documents to really define, I think, set the foundation really for the business and make sure everything's clear cut. And we know, like you said, who owns what and where the lines are drawn, and that this is a 50-50 partnership. And it can get dicey if you wait too long to do that stuff. I think naturally for us, our skill sets, they complement each other, and that he's a lot better at certain things that I'm not, frankly, and vice versa. Do you find that to be the case for the two of you? You know, Ben, you have a background in law, so do you tend to lead more of the sort of operations, and Stephen, communications and marketing, or how does that split fall?
Yeah, for sure. 100%. Yeah. I mean, like early on, especially, you know, it was just the two of us. I mean, having Stephen's kind of, you know, brand focus was, I mean, it's stuff that like was always so squishy and amorphous for me as a lawyer. Mm-hmm. Like I never understood marketing, and especially working in a law firm, law firms don't do marketing, or if they do it, they do it extraordinarily poorly. Mm-hmm. At least the ones that I've been in contact with, compared to, you know, like the kind of more global brands around the world. So like having him be able to do that was great. And then, you know, like just my lane was one that, you know, Stephen, you know, had no interest in doing as well. I don't think. Stephen, you can correct me if I'm wrong, if there's like a secret lawyer deep inside you. But
no, but also in things, you know, leaked out in smaller ways. Like I hate reading long documents. It's just something I'm not good at, not a fan of it. And that translates to long emails too. And so before we had a real team, Ben and I were CC'd on like every single email, and Ben would do this thing that I've noticed where he would like Slack me. It was like, hey, do you see that email from so-and-so? Here's the deal. Where it was very much, he knew I wasn't going to like get bogged down in it and like read it and cliff notes it for me. And like, you know, like there's a lot of really small things like that, that hard to quantify and and you put a count on that showed up, and you recognize those things in each other. Like, and if you're really good and successful, I think you just become good at noticing those things and helping each other out.
Mm-hmm. You know, you bring up email, and I think that's leads me into the section I wanted to explore today with you guys. Is you've really seemed to establish a strong company culture. And one of those is how you communicate with each other and your team. And I read somewhere that you don't use email, it's Slack only. And I think that's amazing for us. I mean, we are constantly trying to figure out the best way to communicate and make sure where everyone's getting the details that they need and trying to consolidate, but email has still been such a huge part of our communication. How have you guys done that transition to Slack strictly?
Yeah. I mean, from the beginning, it came up. I don't remember, we started using Slack, I mean, really early, but so no internal emails allowed, obviously, if you're communicating with external people, but a lot of our staff, that's not really a thing that they do. Mm-hmm. And so for us, I think both Ben and I hated inbox purgatory, right? Just every day you're spending hours on email. And so started using Slack, and then I'm a really big, weirdly, like, systems and process guy. Like, I get really excited about things like GTD and getting things done. And so from the beginning, we organized it. And so every launch that we have and has its own Slack thread, and every team has their own Slack thread, every project. And so we're really, really gangster about you talking about that launch on that thread. And so started from the beginning, it's onboarded. At first, people were kind of murky about it, and I'd reply to emails. Is Slack broken? That's like all I reply to emails about. and it really just, because there's a lot of importance here. One is transparency. If there's a project, usually multiple people are working on it. And so having a two-way conversation, unless it absolutely needs to be private, is just kind of damaging. It creates redundancy, right? Mm-hmm. And then usually 10 people know the answer to a question. And so you ask it on a Slack thread, first person can do it. And so really, it really hinges around, I think, transparency and stopping these one-on-one conversations that don't need to happen. And we did it early on, and so now it is ingrained. And I mean, trying to do it at a large company, I'm sure would be way harder than how we have it now. Mm-hmm. Ben, I don't know if there's anything you want to add.
No, I mean, I echo all of that. It's like Slack's not perfect by any means. None of the messaging systems are.
Yeah.
But it's worlds better than email. You know, with the organizational techniques, you can do a top-down organizational kind of structure, right? Like Stephen was saying, you can force everything into one channel, whereas with email, it's kind of all over the map. And one of the big benefits too is that we are, I don't want to say immune from, but let's say less prone to phishing attacks, for example, because, you know, the people, like, there's, you know, a ton of hackers out there who will get, you know, will spoof like Steven's email, for example, and try to email our AP person and be like, hey, would you send a wire to this company? And instantly you can be like, well, that's fake, because Steven would never send an email. So there's kind of like second and third benefits, you know, tertiary benefits to that, that are really nice. Not something we planned on, but kind of as it kind of shook out, we're like, oh, this is actually very a nice little benefit.
Mm-hmm. So when you, I just want to jump in here real quick.
Oh, go ahead. No, please.
I think that those are all excellent points, and it kind of leads me into just how you were thinking and formulating and starting your business. And we work with a lot of like D2C brands, and like D2C is definitely like the hot topic. It's a hot word right now. You know, for me, I see this more D2C as like a distribution model versus a actual business model. And I'm really curious to, you know, when you were starting goodr, you started out as a D2C. Now you've gone into this sort of wholesale world. You're working with retail partners all over. So, you know, do you think it's necessary for D2C brands to expand their distribution to retailers in order to grow?
And I think it varies. I think it really depends. We've seen, you know, we started as a D2C brand. Like, that's what we were. Yeah. We started getting interest from retailers from our, you know, our margin. We could do it. And so we went into B2B pretty quickly. And we kind of saw this, this slide of most of our business direct to consumer, then 2/3 of our business being B2B. And now we're back the other way. And so they do feed each other. I think you absolutely have to have a healthy direct consumer brand in this day and age. We saw that in COVID. I mean, that's what allowed us to keep going and thriving. Mm-hmm. And so it really depends. I think it's good. And I think one of the main reasons is you need a lot of free advertising being in stores. And so if you can make it work for you, it helps you more than hurts you, as long as you don't let it get too big.
Yeah. I to Stephen's point, I mean, there's some, as long as you make sure you're not kind of sacrificing financially or operationally even to get into stores. I mean, you know, this isn't the 1980s anymore. You don't need to be in Nordstrom's to get your name out there. Mm-hmm. There's so many other ways to do that. And so just making sure that there's going to be some deals you just say no to, and being aware of that, just because either they're asking for too steep a discount, or, you know, they're asking for too much from you operationally. I mean, if some of the vendor manuals we get now from some of the bigger retailers are like 100 pages long of things they require from you. If it was just myself and Steven doing that, it would be a nightmare. I mean, it'd be all we do is like take care of that one vendor, and you kind of then get into the situation where your energy is way too focused on one thing. Once you have a team who can handle that and who can focus on it, it's not the biggest ask. But yeah, just making sure that you're not you know, focusing on it to the detriment of your DTC.
Mm-hmm. So, you know, looking deeper into goodr, you built the brand on basically four pillars, and I think that's really helped set the stage for the culture, the rich culture that I was speaking to earlier. And I'm just going to read them off what I have as one, work hard, play hard. Love that. It's always been a big motto in my life. Two, don't take life too seriously. Three, ever tried, ever failed. No matter, try again, fail better. And four, have fun. So we speak a lot about sustainability and how that is outside, or I should say more than just environmental. And when I look at these four pillars, it really seems that there's an element of sustainability written between the lines of these. You know, basically maintaining spirit, maintaining personality, maintaining focus. You know, what is it that led you to create these? Is this something, these four pillars that you set the brand on, something you did early on, or did these evolve as you started hiring people and working more?
Where'd you get those from? I'm curious, because I don't have those as our four.
I would love to hear your four. I got them from a site called Goodwire that had an article about you guys.
Yeah, I mean, I think I think you captured the essence of it. Sorry, but
yes. I would love to hear. Please correct me.
No. You know, I always think about it's hard what we focus on now versus, I think have fun is absolutely what we started with. Yeah. We thought running was fun. And so we wanted to build a brand around that. You know, our three things, our two core values are have fun, authenticity. So making the goal being, if the goal is being, authentic and people don't like you, it's okay. If the goal is being liked, people don't like you, you're fucked. It's like, we don't need to be liked. We just need to be ourselves. And the third one in there is challenging the status quo. And there's a lot that wraps up in that. And, you know, I think Ben and I talk about this a lot. Love sunglasses, and it's a really fun brand. But what the coolest thing about having a successful brand is, being able to invest in things like 1%, for the planet, which I'll let Ben talk about. And then for me, it's being able to run the culture. We put people first at our company. It's a really important thing. Mm-hmm. And so the business is awesome, but it has allowed us to do other things that we're passionate about. And like, that has made all the difference.
Yeah, I actually discovered you guys through 1% for the Planet. So we're members as well. I was at the event in Portland a couple of years ago. You guys are giving out free sunglasses. And that was my introduction to goodr. And I actually haven't bought a single pair outside of goodr since, because they're fantastic. But Ben, I would love to hear what sort of inspired that idea, or that, you know, joining 1%.
Yeah, I mean, I think pretty early on, we, you know, as part of, you know, I think we made, I don't know how large we were, Stephen, but we started doing Read Goodr. Like, we just had this, we had like a monthly book club essentially internally. It was, I mean, maybe there was 10 people there. Maybe it might've been less than that even.
It was early 18. Yeah.
Yeah. And I think one of the first books we read was Let My People Surf by Yvon Chouinard. And it was, you know, I knew some about Patagonia's story and kind of what their values were. But it was just very kind of inspirational to see this billion-dollar company kind of bucking the trend of sacrificing your values in order to grow bigger, and that indeed you don't need to do that. It's not a it's not a zero-sum game. It's not, you know, for every value you trade off, that you get this many dollars. They kind of prove that you can maintain who you are and make an insane amount of money. I mean, you talk to any entrepreneur out there, if they told you your business is worth $1 billion, they would take that in a heartbeat. So, I mean, that was hugely inspirational. And then obviously within that, we learned about 1% for the planet. And it, you know, had that conversation. It was a pretty easy decision, from both Stephen and I, as far as, you know, making that commitment early on so that it doesn't become, you know, cause when your 1% is maybe $1,000, then you know that's pretty easy. But if you are $100 million company and all of a sudden you're going to donate $1 million, then you start to think, well, I mean, $1 million, is that too much, is this and that? But like, by percentage, it's the same. And so making that commitment early on was super important to kind of maintain that. And it the nice thing too is it kind of in, you know, ingrained in us this kind of idea of giving back. And so, you know, we work with, I mean, a ton of charities, even outside of 1% that are, you know, aren't included in that 1% calculation. And it's never a question if, you know, someone approaches us and wants to do like a co-brand to promote stuff. So we did one with like the Denver Zoo recently. And it was, you know, basically donated all proceeds. And that was an easy decision because it's just part of our culture now. And 1% kind of helped us, you know, basically make that commitment and make it real, something more than just like window dressing. Something that's, you know, we're legally bound to make these commitments. And I, you know, as a lawyer, I love that. You put something down on paper that means something in my mind. So.
And, you know, going back to the idea of culture, and this that question is really directed at Stephen in a way, you know, having that idea of fun and really making sure that, that's like alive and well in the company. How do you sort of integrate that into your marketing in a sustainable way?
It's a really interesting, you know, if you see the brand, the absurdity and the irreverency is basically a direct reflection of myself, Ben, and Carrie, who's also our third co-founder, when she went to high school with us too. And I think what's interesting is I think sometimes when people see our brand from the outside, they think that we just sit around and slam margaritas all day. And so we've had to do a lot of work to communicate what we mean by fun. And to us, fun is being good. Like, that's really important, and being inclusive and being inspiring. Fun is not celebrating without hard work. And we work really, really hard. And something that's a constant reminder in our culture is goodr is a fun place to work if you love the work. It's not an easy place to work, actually. And that's something we had to kind of come to a head with in the past couple of years. You know, we're 75 people now, and really understanding what we mean by fun. And so it's been a really fun, no pun intended, fun journey to figure that out and make sure that we're living into that value ourselves. Did that answer your question?
It does. And I'm curious to what, you say it's hard. Like, what makes it hard? Is it, what are the challenges that you face as like a unique brand?
Yeah. You know, and I think, so for example, it is, so goodr, we do quarterly reviews. We don't do yearly. So every quarter we have a quarterly review process, and we're really big on feedback. And what we learned early on is when we onboarded people is that there's a fair amount of deprogramming we have to do because people aren't used to our culture, and people are not used to giving nor receiving feedback. And so we train people how to do that. And quarterly, I still sit in every quarterly review, and there's a committee, and people are like, hey, here's what I've done. And so it's kind of a, like, so people have to, they're on the hook. You can't hide at goodr. It's actually impossible. And I think that's an uncommon thing. You know, when you work at a company and there's Janice over in the corner that's been there for 15 years and nobody quite knows what Janice does.
Yeah.
That doesn't exist. That doesn't exist at goodr. And so I think the big thing is you can't hide. And that is different than a lot of places.
Yeah. I read through some of the, in the same article that I quoted earlier. So I hope this is accurate.
Yeah.
But I read through some of your onboarding stuff, and your applicant process. And, you know, is it true that you have people test draw an octopus?
Well, it's an octopus fighting a pirate.
Yes, there you go. Octopus fighting a pirate. There we go. Okay. That's amazing.
Yeah, you have no idea how hard it is to get, say, people applying for an accountancy job to take that requirement seriously. I literally passed over dozens of applications from very competent people for our finance team who just didn't draw the picture. I was like, come on, we're serious. We even put in brackets, we're serious.
I think it's brilliant. And I would love to hear how you came to that idea and what drove it. Were you just seeing that you weren't getting the type of people that you wanted? How'd that come about?
Ben, do you remember? It's fuzzy in my mind.
Yeah, I mean, I legitimately think it's one of those. So, I mean, this is an extension of all the irreverency that Stephen was talking about. So it started as something funny. So I think in addition to, you know, drawing that picture, we also require that people be okay with wrestling with a golden retriever. And what was the Bosley requirement? There was
something with bassinet. I can't remember.
Yeah, but basically, you know, it was kind of a joke. I mean, obviously, you know, it's recommended you wrestle with my golden retriever because he's wonderful. But it's obviously not a requirement. But I think what we found is that as we move forward and kept that requirement, the people who sent us the picture, who actually did it, were by and large one more. They're probably more likely to get our culture and want to be there. And two, when you give someone a task before you're giving them money, and they do it, it's a good indication that they're the kind of person that they're a doer. You know, they don't sit back. They see they kind of see an opportunity, and you know, it's gone beyond that too, where, you know, there's people who've gone above and beyond anything like that. I remember someone brought a shrimp cocktail one time, right?
Yeah.
So, I mean, it's that kind of thing. I don't think any of these things are you know, absolutely necessary. And like I said, I'm sure we've glossed over very capable candidates who didn't draw the picture, but I think it's, you know, hiring's hard, and anything you can do to try to get some indication of, you know, an applicant's actual desire to be there and be with your company rather than just collect a paycheck. I mean, do whatever you can.
I remember the origin of it now. Ben wrote on our website, the return policy, and the return policy, there's a line that says, you know, to issue return, and we're serious about it, you must also submit a drawing of an octopus fighting a pirate.
Yeah.
And so our customers would do it. And it was a really funny thing. And so when we started actually hiring people that weren't our friends, I just always loved that. And so I just threw that on there as a requirement. And to Ben's point, it's a litmus test. And it shows, one, you read the whole thing, and two, that you're willing to work. And it's still there. We throw your resume in the garbage if it doesn't come with this. And it can be the worst drawing in the world. That's not the point. It's the point that you did it.
Mm-hmm. I feel like I should frame those and have a wall of submissions.
Oh, we're collecting them. We're now that we have a DC, I legit have a box full of them that I want. But at some point, we're going to decoupage a wall with them and make it wallpaper.
Oh, that's awesome. Or if someone... You could do a tattoo. Someone's got to get a tattoo of one of them.
Well, there, four of our staff members got a tattoo of Carl on one trip. Carl the Flamingo, our mascot. So that was pretty cool.
That's dedication. That's loyal.
Yep.
Yeah, it is.
So continuing on with the idea of your onboarding process, you know, I'm really fascinated by it because I haven't quite seen or read about other companies' onboarding process quite like yours. And, you know, I think there's a lot of interesting ideas behind it. And so, you know, I love the idea of, and correct me again if this is wrong, that you, you know, have a 15-minute connection call with every employee. So they got to call everyone. It's like a sort of a personality test. And what else are you guys kind of doing to help facilitate that integration into your culture?
Yeah, I mean, we recognized early on that our culture is so different. We have to do a fair amount of deprogramming. And so that's kind of where this came from. We have a podcast called the Culture Goodr Podcast, and we actually did a whole episode on our onboarding because it's so vast. But it basically, it's 3 months. It's really intensive. The first week, you actually don't even really do anything like close to your role. So everybody, we use what's called the Enneagram. And so everybody gets like tested for that. It's like basically like your, like a personality test that we work off of. We use GTD, which is getting things done. It's how it's productivity and product management. So everybody's taught that. Everybody in the first 3 months has to set up and do a 15-minute connection call with everybody at the entire company. Because, you know, you work for companies sometimes and you never talk to people. You're like, oh, that new person started. I don't know who they are. And we just never wanted to become that. Mm-hmm. And so the four questions are, you know, what do you do at goodr? What do you do outside of goodr? What's your spirit animal and why? And if you had unlimited funds, where would you take a month-long trip to? And so everybody does that. Also, obviously, everybody goes and gets a bunch of free sunglasses. And I know there's other things involved, like scavenger hunt. And then within the first 3 months, everybody has to, we have 12 different flocks. So like ops, finance, content, design. Each flock leader does a 30-minute deep dive of like, hey, here's what our flock does. Here's our values. Here's who's on the team. And so that everybody just gets a really full picture of our ecosystem. And it's like kind of an immersion.
And so are you finding that you're attracting a certain personality type? You know, you're taking the sort of personality tests in a way. Are you finding that there's just a general type of person that's drawn to working at goodr?
You know, early on, Carrie and I did the vast majority of the hiring. So we use the Enneagram. So there's like type 7. So like I'm a type 7, Ben's a type 5, Carrie's type 9. And early on, when we started to use Enneagram, when we first got tested, we were disproportionately 7s and 9s. And we were laughing. We're like, well, that's what happens when Carrie and Steven do all the hiring. And now we have a team that does it. Our hiring process is 7 steps. The first 2 are blind now. And so in the past year and a half, we've gotten a lot more diverse because of all these things we added in. And so I think early on, yes, now it's quite a bit different. I think the one common thing is what Ben talked to is people who end up here want to work and want to do good work. And and I think that's shown by them making it through our pretty in-depth hiring process now.
Now you talked earlier about how you put people first, and it sounds like that just from our conversation so far. But I would love to hear more about like what you're doing to help continue to build the goodr community, to help continue like to build the relationships amongst your team and how you're putting people first. You know, do you have like specific, like I saw you have tons of like races and stuff on your site. Is that part of it?
Yeah. I mean, one is just, we really want people to get better. And so, so that goes back to the quarterly reviews, clear feedback. We have a lot of continuing education. Part of our early on, have you read Daniel Pink's book Drive?
I have not.
So, it's amazing. And early on, like in 2017, when we realized like, oh, we have real people and we have to give pay raises and performance system. And we looked at Drive, and Drive is an amazing book that Daniel Pink does on like what really motivates people. And there are 3 things. There's autonomy. Making your own decisions. There's mastery, getting better at something that matters, and purpose, doing something bigger than yourself. And so Ben and I actually were like the architect of AMP. And so we call AMP autonomy, mastery, purpose. And it is how we run the company. And so autonomy is like a lot of your job and sharing what you do. Mastery is everybody takes on a mastery project every year of like improving a skill. And then purpose is 10% time of doing something. Maybe it's working for a nonprofit. I think Ben's first perfect project was getting us on 1% for the planet. And so we have a lot of these things there that's like, it's really gauged at making people better and making the world better. Mm-hmm. And I know if anything you want to add there.
No, I mean, it pretty much nails it. But yeah, to Stephen's, just to expand on one thing, you know, the idea of letting, like, having people be, you know, kind of leaving people better than they arrived in some respects is kind of my, is the dream behind AMP in my mind. And I know there's a ton of, you know, there's a ton of jobs out there that you can get that you're kind of meant to tread water at. You know, I don't know. I've never worked at Amazon, for example, but I can't imagine the upward mobility of a, you know, DC worker at Amazon's great at all. And that mm-hmm. always bothered me. I kind of wanted, no matter what your job is, you know, I'd want there to be a chance or an ability to get better at something. And, you know, even if that's, you know, working your way through and becoming like the lead DC person, or, you know, running a warehouse, becoming a COO, whatever that might be, or maybe it's, I'm working at DC, but I really want to do graphic design. Well, for us, if someone were to come to us in our DC and say, hey, you know, working at DC is fine, but my real passion is to become a graphic designer, would you be willing to, you know, pay for a subscription to Adobe? Or, you know, would you be willing to come, you know, kind of reimburse me for classes I'm going to take online for design? I mean, I'd say they're almost unequivocally, the answer would be yes, because we want people to get better at something that matters to them. I mean, even if it doesn't necessarily have to do with their job, we could, I mean, it's pretty easy for us to be sold in that for that reason. And, you know, just because we want people, even if they, you know, a good outcome for us is someone leaves goodr for a better job, I would say. I mean, Stephen, you can correct me if
I agree.
I'm being a little too, yeah.
I'll stop.
No, I think for us, that means that someone came to goodr, hopefully they got better at a skill that mattered, and they were able to leverage that into a better job than we can provide. Obviously, we would, you know, if we could counter that and keep them, we would try our best. But if, you know, we've had people leave, like actually RDC, for example, I think one gentleman in particular who left for an amazing job, and I was just like, you know, we were crushed because he was so good and he did his job so well, but the job he's going to was awesome. So you're just, mm-hmm. all you can do is just be like, just be happy for him. So, mm-hmm.
You know, I think we touched on it a little bit earlier, but there's that idea that, you know, this actually takes away from the bottom line of a business. And I argue it doesn't, but, are you seeing returns, in your growth as a business, from the focus on keeping, your employees happy, engaged, learning, and finding out what motivates them to do their best?
Yeah, I agree, Jonathan. I push back on that. I think it's quite the opposite. You know, we value high performers. We train people because the expectation is that you're perfect or that you never fail, that you learn and just keep growing. And, you know, we track a revenue per employee. That's kind of a metric we use. And I think we excel with much less people than a lot of companies our size because of all of this work we put into the staff.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And so, like, obviously we've been going through like really challenging year, emotionally, stress wise, whether it's business or at home. And morale is just like one of these constant things that I think needs to be, or at least be some social listening, at least on your teams. You know, what are you doing to like keep the morale up amongst your 75 employees?
Yeah, man, it's, you know, it's no playbook for this, right? I always pride myself in having backup plans for the backup plans, just a pandemic backup plan never made it to the list. but, you know, I think a couple of things. One is we were always a 60% virtual company. So even before COVID, you had been in the office Tuesdays and Thursdays, Monday, Wednesday, Friday was optional. Mm-hmm. And because of Slack and a lot of other things, we were able to pivot really easy to this virtual world. So that was a gift. And so fatigue is real right now. Screen fatigue, just general world fatigue, you know, not to mention, just everything's going on this year, Black Lives Matter, the election, like this has been a heavy fucking year. Mm-hmm. And it's something that is just top of mind. And so, what are we doing? One is during our weekly staff meeting. We have it every week. You know, everybody has, puts in a box. It's life overwhelm and goodr overwhelm. And so goodr overwhelm is just workload. And so it's basically a red, yellow, green, right? Like green mm-hmm. is good, yellow issues, red is you got problems. And it's obviously, we actually define those a little bit clearer than that. But, and so we added the personal one so that we give people a space to kind of own like, hey, I'm doing my job. I'm just not okay. And so every week, everybody updates this. And if it's directly related to goodr, your team leader connects with you and is like, hey, what's going on? Like, well, how can I help? What can we move around? You know, spend less time on this. If it's connected to life, we actually have a person on staff, Sean, his title is Chief Relationship Officer, and he'll reach out and be like, hey, what's going on? What do we need? And so the big thing is we're creating space for people not to be okay. Like it's because it's just okay not to be okay. And, and we're doing other things, you know, virtual happy hours and stuff, but it's just, it's hard. And also I think sometimes after you spend all day working and on video calls, the last thing you want to do is sit on another Zoom call and have a
exactly. Drink. Yeah. I mean, I'm, you speak to fatigue. I'm definitely fatigued on, the Zoom phenom that's popped up. I don't think it's necessarily sustainable over the next few years. I mean, my calendar used to be full of phone calls and now suddenly they're just full of video calls, but nothing's really changed. I wouldn't have saw them anyway. You know, so it's definitely not sustainable long-term, but you know, for the time being, I always put the note, I give a note in there, as you say, give them the space to say, you can just call me if you want. It doesn't have to be to be a video. And I think that's a really important point, is to make sure you're giving your people space to feel things. Because oftentimes we're told, you know, not to share, especially in a workplace.
Yeah. Yeah. I start pinging people, hey, do we need to look at anything on this call? Especially if it's a one-on-one, like, can we just do it on a call? Like, can we just go on mm-hmm. a walk? Like,
mm-hmm.
yeah.
Mm-hmm. There's a level of social listening or listening to your employees and team. Are you extending that into your community as far as like your goodr customers? How are you doing the social listening and hearing them? So you're not, you know, selling when it's inappropriate or when they're not ready to hear those messages and so forth?
Man, it's a good question. You know, we made a decision early on in COVID to, we're a fun brand, we're an irreverent brand, and we really stayed away from, oh, how to keep busy. And, you know, we just wanted to give people actually a respite from mm-hmm, COVID. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And so that's real, you know, but I think the most things you don't see that we do, right? Like, oh, this is going on. We should move that launch. Like, this is not a right time to launch a product. You know, obviously, Blackout Tuesday, and really just listening to what's going on. But I would say that most of the things we do, you don't see because we move them or push them because of what's going on in the world. But this is not an easy year. And understanding that our customers are, you know, we're very inclusive and our customers represent a big thing. And so we just try and be ourselves and as empathetic as possible.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And I mean, maybe more granular and day to day, we have an incredible customer service team. And they, God bless them, they deal on the front lines with people who I think oftentimes are, you know, like you said, are just going through a rough year, like everyone is, mm-hmm, mm-hmm. and maybe take out their frustrations in the wrong way with the wrong people. Mm-hmm. But they do a really good job of, like Stephen says, trying to approach every conversation with empathy, even if they aren't receiving the same treatment in return. And, you know, they will share emails with the whole team on Slack of people who are just awesome. And so, you know, to any of our customers that are out there listening that share happy things with our customer service, thank you so much, because you make their day and mm-hmm. honestly make our day. We really care about our customers. And so we take complaints and we take concerns, all this kind of stuff extremely seriously. We respond, we we try to respond to every email like in under 24 hours. And for a company, that's our size, that's not easy to do. And our customer service folks are, they do an incredible job to try and hit that mark. It's something that we, like, on the day to day, we pay attention to.
Mm-hmm. They're doing God's work. And the other thing, Ben, you probably speak to how we approached our retailers in May and April when COVID hit. Because a lot of our accounts are small, run shops, mom and pops. And I don't know, Ben, if you could kind of speak to like the approach we took there. Because like we exercise a lot of empathy with even our B2B partners.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, in March, obviously, everyone was terrified. I mean, like we had no idea where this was going to go. And, being a little candid here, our B2B accounts dropped, our sales on like from year over year dropped 90%. Mm-hmm. I mean, which is just, your heart goes in your throat when you see something like that. When you look at the numbers, you're just like, we may not survive this. And we were able to stabilize, around, end of April, May, to a point where it was no longer an existential threat. I wasn't worried about if we were gonna be able to pay payroll anymore. I was still, and still am, very worried about, just general business things, but
of course,
no longer an existential threat. But, once we kind of stabilized, and actually even before, I still sit in on our finance meetings with our VP of finance and our controller and our AP person, NAR person. And we talked about, we had customers who were on 30-day terms. They'd buy sunglasses from us and then they'd pay us 30 days later. We basically reached out to, the person in charge of reaching out and dealing with the customers for payment basically reached out in a very kind of hopefully sympathetic and empathetic way, as far as like, hey, listen, we would obviously love for you to pay us on time, because we need the money and cash flow is the thing for business. But given that those stores were shut down and people couldn't go to them and buy things, and indeed some of them are still at like 10%. I mean, we basically told them that we weren't going to make any collection efforts. So if they couldn't pay us, they couldn't pay us. And we kind of let people pay us whenever they could. And I will tell you that from orders that were due when the pandemic hit, I think we have been fully paid up. It took a lot longer, but no one welched on what they owed us. They eventually paid up when they could. And it's really kind of heartwarming to see that our kindness was repaid with them repaying us, I guess literally repaying us. So it's good. And so we are just kind of trying to understand, like, cause our retailers are our customers as well. Just, they're just as important as, D2C customers. And so we want to make sure we take care of them. Cause I mean, especially early on, those like single, store run shops were huge for us. They did so much work in just like pumping our brand's tires and making sure people knew about us. And like, people would walk in their stores and they would talk us up. And so I will never forget that. Like, they're great for us and we want to be as helpful as we can to be for them. So.
Mm-hmm. Gentlemen, I appreciate all your time today. I know you have a very packed schedule. So I'm going to start to wrap things up a bit. And as we do, I just want to give another shout out to 1% for the Planet, because I think they're doing such great work. And I'm aware you make their own sort of special pair of sunglasses. Is that right?
Yeah. 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 We worked with them to create a kind of fully, recycled pair, basically. Yeah.
So it's made from trash.
Yeah, that's amazing. Like recycled plastics.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's amazing.
Yeah, we call them these shades are trash, was the name of the colorway. So yeah.
Yeah, I love the names you have on your shades. I have the ones I have on my head, I think, are the ginger soul, or the other ones. Which is, I fall into that category. As blonde as I am, I can't spend more than 3 minutes in the sun before turning bright red. Yeah. So I'm just gonna direct people to your site, goodr. It's goodr.co.
Goodr.com.
.com.
Yeah.
Can they people buy the 1% sunglasses on your site? Are they up right now?
We sold out.
Okay.
Yeah, we sold out, but they sold out so much quicker than we ever thought. It was a huge success. So we're talking with 1%. We're going to do it again next year for Earth Day.
Awesome.
And I may be stepping on toes here, but I'll go ahead. I think even REI might be in on that launch this time around because they were super excited about it. So yeah, we're doing it again. We're super excited about it. It's, you know, obviously 1% is huge for us. Anything we can do to get their message out more broadly is awesome. And they will be available again kind of in a few months, I guess.
Great. Well, thank you. Congrats on that. REI, that's a great partner to have.
Sure. Yeah, they're awesome.
Well, congrats. And thanks again, gentlemen.
Awesome. Thanks, Jonathan.
And John, this is a pleasure.
If you have any questions, comments, or want to be on the show, please email me personally at j@weareunconquered.co.